So, welcome to the Saturday night panel, The Bonfire of the Vanities. When Gwen asked me to moderate tonight, it came with a warning. After 3 days of agreement and disagreement, late nights at the bar, not to mention a little bit of wine, Saturday's session, she said, can sometimes get a bit raucous. Well, hopefully tonight's will be no different. But first, just to reinforce the ground rules so that we can get to the real bonfire of the vanities tonight at midnight, a reminder that each of the panelists tonight will speak for 20 minutes. We'll then have a 15-minute break, followed by a Q&A. And we're going to do our best to be finished by 10. So just to frame tonight's panel a little bit, thus far, we've looked at the 2008 global economic meltdown through a number of lenses. We've heard sound and prescient historical arguments, looked at the role and response of governments both here and abroad, examined and discussed the regulatory environment, talked about productivity and innovation and how Canada might climb out of this mess, and just this morning, examined the notion that nations that have rights also have duties. We've looked at this crisis at a macro level as voyeurs and as critics, but not necessarily as participants. In fact, what we haven't examined and dissected is our own role, that of the consumer and consumerism in all of this, and how we, all of us, as consumers, may in fact have contributed to this crisis. In other words, what our personal responsibility might be. And in fact, are we getting what we deserve? Tonight's panel promises to make us think a little more about that. So to introduce our distinguished panel and very cool panel, note that everyone is dressed in a very dark and cool kind of way. I'm very pleased to introduce Professor Joseph Heath. To quote a recent Walrus magazine review, a lot of popular theorists sell themselves by making their audience feel smart. Call it the platitudes for dummies formula. Establish, you've probably read this, establish your credentials and then tactfully explain to readers what they already know. Joseph Heath is the opposite, spinning good reads out of very complicated ideas. The author of three meaty but very engaging popular works, The Efficient Society, The Rebel Cell, and now Filthy Lucre, Economics for People Who Hate Capitalism, Heath respects his readers' intellectual curiosity and shows them a good time without resorting to glorified common sense. He possesses a rare combination of talents, an appreciation for the nitty-gritty, and the ability to translate even the most difficult ideas into an accessible language. Professor Heath is a professor in the Department of Philosophy in the School of Public Policy and Governance at the University of Toronto. Born in Saskatoon, Gwen. He received his BA from McGill University with, actually, at the same time as our illustrious president, Madame Burroughs, and his PhD from Northwestern. Our second speaker this evening is Peter Wintonick. Today, Peter described himself to me as a documentary diplomat or an ambassador of all things documentary. He told me he became a filmmaker because he wanted to explore the connection between media and dissonant thinking, which he has done brilliantly with the seminal documentary Manufacturing Consent, Noam Chomsky and the Media, and more recently as editorial advisor to the Toronto Film and Sundance Film Festival hit Last Train Home. Interesting to also note that in 1973-1974, Peter took his first editing job in Montreal, where he continues to live, editing the campaign film for former Prime Minister Pierre Elliott Trudeau, where his interest in public policy clearly was piqued. Our third panelist tonight is Jennifer Corriero. And today, I noted that on Jennifer's Twitter page, she describes herself as a social entrepreneur who creates opportunities for youth engagement leveraging social media. She is co-founder and executive director of Taking It Global, a website that has over 300,000 members and which receives about 1.8 million hits per day. In 2005, she was named a young global leader by the World Economic Forum, and just this year received a Global Youth Talent Award by a government in Spain. Her Twitter name is Jennergy. Peter, in fact, who traveled with Jennifer on a youth engagement mission to Brazil with our Governor General, Michael Jean, last year, says it describes her perfectly. In fact, earlier, not today, I guess last night, Jennifer tweeted the following. And I quote, is this a retweet if I'm reading it? Is this an RT? I'm not sure. Is this an RT retweet? You'll learn a lot tonight, those of you who don't tweet. Anyway, it went as follows. Unless you can bounce with me, it is tough to hang beyond the time between my way up or down, or if I get stuck, let's bounce. Ladies and gentlemen, let's bounce.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you very much for inviting me to give a little talk. So as was mentioned, I'm a philosophy professor, and I think because of that, I get a lot of calls from journalists. Whenever something sort of big happens, journalists call me to find out if this is finally the tipping point in the decline of Western civilization, like if we've reached the point of no return. So like last week, in all seriousness, some earnest young fellow called me to find out whether I thought the Lady Gaga's latest video is really the point of no return. Whether the violent imagery might contaminate the minds of youth and lead to rampant criminality. I said, well, which turnip truck did you just fall off? During the financial crisis, I got a lot of those, like the volume of those calls increased with somewhat greater justification because there were some tense moments there. But I did my bit, you know, in saying to all of them that no, this is not the end of civilization, that for the most part, this is just people behaving badly, and that, you know, the universe will continue much as it has. To which the follow-up question inevitably was, well, why were people behaving so badly? And can't you do something about it? Because I teach ethics, I teach business ethics, I teach public administration ethics. You know, you guys dropped the ball, people were behaving unethically. And then I'm asked to sort of speculate about, what this means about rampant greed in our civilization, whether it's a culture of consumerism and so forth. And I have to say that despite the fact that people often refer to the philosophy department as the department of data-free speculation, which, you know, somebody's got to do it, right? It's like you guys and us. I actually, in this case, I'm sort of aware of the limits of armchair speculation when it comes to understanding why people behave badly. And partly that's because I'm aware of a sort of body of academic literature put together by some people who actually study professionally why people behave badly, namely criminologists. And criminologists, that's one of their major aspects of their professional mandate. Is to find out why people behave badly. And one of the nice things about that, one of the real advantages that criminologists have over ethicists is that criminologists have easy access to a target population of people who have behaved badly. With morality, it's harder to recruit people for your study, right? Like, you put an ad in adulterers, please come to the show. Whereas criminologists can just walk right out and say, you know, they get permission from Corrections Canada, and then they can ask people who have committed crimes, what the hell were you thinking, or you know, why were you behaving so badly? And as it turns out, criminals have very interesting things to say about why they behave badly. And one of the interesting features of this literature is that criminologists actually don't give a lot of credence to what you might call our folk theories of criminal motivation. That is that, you know, if you read the paper, most of us in our day-to-day lives, we have certain kinds of theories about why people engage in criminal behavior. And it's interesting to discover that none of those theories are held in very high regard by people who actually study the matter. So, for example, we often think of criminals as people with some kind of a defect of character or people who have the wrong values. So the thought is that, you know, we have some concept of what's good and they have it like an inverted version of it. And so they call stuff we call good, they think is bad, and stuff we think is bad, they think is good. Or that they lack character, and so like their parents didn't raise them right and so forth, and that's how they grew up to be criminals. That's actually not a particularly a well-regarded theory, partly because it doesn't really have a lot of empirical confirmation. And it's particularly not the case with respect to white-collar criminals, which is what we're interested in when we talk about the financial crisis. There was an enormous amount of white-collar crime. There was a lot of unethical behavior as well. The criminal behavior was sort of a subset of it. But white-collar criminals, the thing which most distinguishes them is their ordinariness. That is that they're not particularly different from you and me or any other person. And so one of the other theories that gets bounced around as well is this idea that somehow that it was greed, that greed is what's responsible for it. And that's also not a highly regarded theory. And I mean, there are a variety of reasons for that. Often when people say, oh, greed, it's actually not proposed as an explanation. It's because they're mystified. Like they can't figure out why, you know, somebody who's a pillar in the community, you know, who has, you know, access to basketball courts and recreational facilities and so forth, nevertheless decides at the age of 45 to pursue a life of crime. It's a very mysterious phenomenon. So often we say, oh, it must be greed. But it's actually not a serious explanation. It's often that we're sort of groping around for an explanation, that we hit on this idea that it's greed. But really, the problem with greed, again, is that it's too common a motive. That is, if people committed crimes because they were greedy, we would all be committing crimes, simply because most people are greedy. And if you look at, so, I mean, criminologists, within the discipline, there's a kind of inversion of the ordinary question, right? When we look at crime, we're sort of puzzled. We say, why are these people doing these horrible things? But people who study it more carefully, they start to see things backwards. That is, what they start to realize is that if you look at the world just in terms of incentives and opportunity, people should be committing crimes all the time. Because a moderately clever person has multiple opportunities to commit crimes and never get caught. So the real question becomes, the mystery becomes, the puzzle becomes, why aren't people committing crime more often? Right? That's the unusual thing. Given that it's typically in your interest and there are many opportunities to do so, why most people refrain from it? So you get this sort of interesting inversion of the question. And the sort of standard view in the discipline is that there's a kind of, therefore what needs to be explained is a certain kind of failure of social control. So criminologists often talk about social deviance, where deviance is when people fail to respect the rules of society. That's the failure of social control. And one of the interesting things that's sort of turned up in the analysis then within theories of deviance is that, again, the kind of deviance that's typically involved in crime, and almost always in the case of white-collar crime, is not a failure on the part of society to impose or to inculcate its values in criminals. There was for a while a sort of subcultural theory that said that, particularly with youth gangs, that they kind of just miss out on like the message that society gives children about what's good and what's bad. And so they wind up with the wrong values. Like they never watch movies or TV where like the cops win or something like that. I mean, it's actually kind of an absurd theory. But I mean, when you study it, it turns out that criminals actually have extremely conventional moral ideas. And it's, again, particularly true of white-collar criminals. That is, criminals, by and large, have the same values that you and I have. They share in the mainstream social consensus about what is right and wrong. And this is, again, part of this puzzle as to why people commit crime. One of the things that also had been noticed for you know, hundreds of years is that criminals rationalize their conduct. And so when you ask criminals what they were doing, they often soft-pedal what they were doing, right? They give some kind of account of it. So in one of the classics of the literature, one of the early works of 20th century sociology, it was a set of interviews with incarcerated embezzlers, so all people who stole money from their employer. And one of the things he particularly drew attention to, this is a Cressy, drew attention to it, was the number of embezzlers who described themselves as having just borrowed the money. You know, just borrowing it, right? Well, when do you intend to pay back? Well, you know, when I got caught. So that was kind of background. Everybody knows that people rationalize their conduct on ethical, illegal behavior. That's not surprising. The really interesting idea that was proposed in the 1950s that I don't think gets enough play and hasn't had enough impact on our kind of folk theories of these things is the development of a theory of what we're called techniques of neutralization by two sociologists named Gresham Sykes and David Matza. And it was a simple insight, but it's brilliant. What they thought was, we all know that people rationalize their behavior. Typically, we assume that that's what people do it after the fact. So they do something wrong, and then afterwards they kind of tell a story to make themselves feel better about it. And their central insight, Sykes and Matsa, was maybe what people are doing is not doing it after the fact, but they're doing it beforehand. In other words, maybe people are adopting a particular way of thinking about or describing their actions, and in so doing, are sort of giving themselves permission to commit the crime. In other words, maybe it's by thinking of it as borrowing that the typical person working in an office starts to become tempted to embezzle because they're not thinking about it as embezzling, they're thinking about it as borrowing. So they developed this view of what they call techniques of neutralization. So the first central idea then is that these rationalizations get adopted beforehand, not after the fact. The second then component of the view is that what criminals are typically misusing are excuses. That is, they are taking what are, in certain circumstances, legitimate excuses for acting contrary to a social norm, but they're making a kind of self-serving use of that excuse. So, for example, as we all know, self-defense is a defense against having hit somebody, having murdered somebody, right? Somebody attacks you, you kill them back. Self-defense is a legitimate excuse. It doesn't justify you, but it excuses the behavior. But there are a lot of self-serving ways of using that appeal to self-defense. Right? Someone, maybe you don't wait until that person actually attacks you, but you think they're probably going to attack you. And so you say, ah, self-defense, I had no choice, and then you attack them. Right? So kind of preemptive attack is an example of a socially deviant or of a self-serving extension of what is in principle a legitimate excuse for violating a social norm or doing something unethical. But in this case, is being used inapplicably. Here's the theory in a nutshell, was that they were studying juvenile delinquents, but they noticed precisely this type of pattern of reasoning. So they said much of delinquency is based on what is essentially an unrecognized extension of defenses to crimes in the form of justifications for deviance that are seen as valid by the delinquent, but not by the legal system or society at large. Right, so this is the idea of a technique of neutralization. Now, what's interesting about it, the reason it's called a neutralization is that it allows the criminal to kind of have his cake and eat it too, or have her cake and eat it too, but almost always his cake. In other words, it allows the person to maintain a kind of positive self-image as a good person. And most unethical people, most criminals, conceive of themselves as good people, right? Because they adhere to the value consensus of the society. They subscribe to and they look up to the caring community priest who always looked after the flock. I mean, that is, they have similar role models, they share similar values, and they want to see themselves as in some way contributing to that. Right, so they maintain a healthy, positive self-image, and yet at the same time, act in ways that are manifestly incompatible with those values and those principles. How do they do it? It's by this self-serving use of excuses. That neutralizes the force of those values. So that even though they subscribe to them kind of abstractly, it doesn't apply to me right now, because, why are you doing that? Well, da-da-da, and then out comes the excuse. So the Sykes and Matsa offered a kind of helpful classification of different categories of neutralization, and I'm just going to mention a few of them because they'll be familiar to all of us. And the reason they're familiar to all of us is that these are, in fact, legitimate excuses in certain circumstances. Right? So, for example, there's the defense of necessity, where you say, I had no choice but to do it. Right? Sometimes that's true, right? But often it's not. You deny that there was injury committed by your behavior. Right? So, you steal money from an insurance company. It's like, nobody even noticed, right? Or you steal from your employer, you say, they didn't even notice the money, or the bank, they say, oh, they have so much money, what's in it? So you say there's no injury. Or you deny that the victim has the status of a victim. So you portray the victim as an aggressor or something like that. You say, oh, they knew what they were getting into when they stepped onto the field. Another one is to appeal to higher loyalties. So you say, yes, I broke the law, but in the name of a higher moral ideal, I had to feed my family or something like that. The other one is condemning the condemners. So you say, the whole system is crooked, the police, they're on the take, it's the judge was biased, et cetera, right? So again, sometimes these things are true, right? But it's possible to make use of these types of excuses in a self-serving way. Now, what's interesting about this then is that these neutralizations are not just rationalizations. They're not just after the fact. They're causally efficacious. That is, being in an environment where one is tempted to make such excuses and where one finds a receptive audience for these types of excusing conditions can itself be criminogenic. I love that word, criminogenic. That is likely to produce crime. This theory actually, it's complicated, of course, like everything empirical. And in the case of street crime, the picture's a lot more complicated. In the case of white collar crime, this account actually has significant probative force. In other words, it fits the model of the white collar criminal extremely well. What's interesting then about it is, you know, where does the social deviance occur, right? So society, in a sense, with criminality, society has kind of failed to control people, has failed to motivate people to engage in pro-social behavior. But the failure has not occurred in the domain of primary values. In other words, it's not as though society has failed to persuade everybody that morality is important or that these are important moral values. Right? At the level of primary values, you have a consensus. What people are doing is, rather than violating the rules that for them are actually kind of have some emotional resonance, right? Like don't steal. I mean, for the most part, people subscribe to that rule. What they're doing is they're violating kind of side, they're doing an end run around them by violating side norms, right? So when you call it borrowing rather than stealing, you're breaking a rule. Right? But it's the rule that has to do with how you use the word borrowing, right? And it's like you're not allowed to call it borrowing if you never intend to give it back. You know, if the person doesn't know you're borrowing, it's not really borrowing. I mean, so you're breaking a rule of English, right? But you're not. I mean, once you've broken that rule of English, you're not breaking the rule of morality, right? Because you weren't stealing, you were borrowing. So you see how that's how the motivation works, right? It's not primary deviance, it's kind of secondary deviance. Now, the other thing that I think is important about this theory is that it's a very relatively cognitivist theory. It suggests that the way people think about what they're doing is really important. Right? It's not like, you know, whether their parents raised them right, or, you know, like whether their grade two teacher was mean to them or something like that. In other words, it's not like character, it's not like your wind-up doll from childhood, you know, programmed for good or evil, right? The way you think about things is really important. And so I want to sort of conclude by saying that you can see also, therefore, you can see the importance of ideology, therefore, in all of this. And I think that one can draw plausible connections between the role of sort of free market ideology and the financial crisis by looking at some of the specific techniques of neutralization that the market economy in general makes available to people. And this is kind of a staple of the literature on white collar crime. But so, for example, competition creates all kinds of opportunities for neutralizing excuses. So, for example, like that excuse of necessity, like I had no choice, is often used. White-collar crime is actually more prominent in failing firms than in successful firms. And one of the reasons is that impending bankruptcy gives people an argument of necessity, where they can say, yes, we broke the rules here and there, but we had no choice. Well, what do you mean you had no choice? Otherwise, the firm would have gone bankrupt. It's like, well, that's not the end of the universe now, is it, right? Like, the firm can go bankrupt. It's not a legitimate argument of necessity. That's a bad thing. It's something you didn't want to happen. But that doesn't actually entitle you to break the law. Right? But it sounds right, right? Because often, you know, it's like do or die moment. Like, this is the way people talk within a failing firm, right? So I just want to draw attention to one sort of ideological element that got a lot of play in the financial crisis in 2008 that you probably heard about, which is the so-called efficient markets hypothesis. And people made fun of it a lot. But the efficient markets hypothesis was the view that essentially the stock market always prices in full information about a firm. People kind of made fun of it. It's not as dumb as it sounds. That is, it's not the markets are omniscient, right? Essentially, it's the view that it's hard to make money on the stock market because there are a lot of people smarter than you. And so, you know, you get some insight about, aha, you know, this firm is probably going to do this. Chances are somebody else with better information than you has already thought of it, right? And furthermore, if you take any particular, sort of thing going on in the company, chances are there are people who know about it. And if the stock price is out of line with what the company is really worth because this information is not public, well, that creates a buying opportunity for the first couple people who find out about it, right? So they buy and so on. And that has the effect of changing the stock price, right? So the stock market winds up, as they say, pricing in information. Now, I mean, so that theory got made fun of a lot. But I should point out then that that theory itself was a very powerful source of sort of neutralizing excuses for both illegal and unethical behavior in the run-up to the financial crisis. And a good example of it, I read this literature, I come across people saying exactly this. They say, for example, like, well, when executives kind of pilfer money from the company, when they, you know, take all kinds of compensation on the side or the perks that are not recorded and this kind of stuff, right? All those kinds of opportunities for graft that exist with respect to senior management. The argument went like this. It said, well, that actually is not taking away money from shareholders. That's just implicit compensation. Because when shareholders buy shares in the firm, I mean, there's all kinds of companies out there. Some of them have very, very strict accounting standards and very strict auditing, and some of them have loose accounting standards and loose auditing, and therefore many opportunities for executive graft, right? And obviously, the shares of the second type of company are going to sell for less, right? Why? Because shareholders knowingly will expect that executives will be taking advantage of the opportunities that are made available to them. And not only that, they get a benefit from it in that they don't have to pay the executives as much, right? If you were to tighten up the accounting standards, then executives would either threaten to leave or they would simply ask for more salary, right? And furthermore, that's not a tax-efficient mode of compensation, right? Because once it's on the books, they have to pay taxes on it. Hey, you're all laughing, but this is like straight out of the literature of people who say this with a straight face, right? So what often look like shady deals of executives taking money that seems like it should have gone to the corporation or seems like it should have gone to shareholders is actually a system of implicit compensation which does not harm shareholders because shareholders have already gotten their shares at a discount because the market has already priced in full information of the opportunities for graft that are available to the firm's executives. Right? Now, this was a view that was taken very seriously by very serious people. But I think when you look at that from the perspective of techniques of neutralization, you can see how, you know what? It might have even been true in some circumstances, right? But once, I mean, just being out there, you know, it's something that so many people want to be true and therefore creates such obvious opportunities for engaging in graft that's not going to be, you know, that is in fact going to be harmful to shareholders. I think it, you know, could plausibly be said to have become a major source of sort of irresponsible behavior. All right, so just to summarize it all, one of the things that's crucial then with these neutralizations, it's very hard to be like a criminal all by yourself. There's a very strong social dimension to crime. So for particular industries have crime problems in a way that other industries don't, right? There's a very social element to it. And partly it's because of this need for a receptive audience. And often when we do have episodes of significant misbehavior, of corporate crime or of occupational crime and so on, we think, oh, the problem then is that, you know, our values, you know, are not being communicated adequately, right? Like, we're not hanging together as a society. So what we need to do in the face of these sort of bad bankers, for example, writing these, you know, rude emails to each other and stuff like that, is that they just don't share our values. So what we need to do is, like, reaffirm our values, right? We gotta, like, hit on those values harder, right? And that, I think, is actually mistaken from this perspective, right? The problem is not that they don't share our values, even though they often don't seem to, right? Often they're just young. When they get... It's not that they don't share their values, right? It's that they have some story that explains why their commitment to these values is not inconsistent with their behavior, right? That is that they have a set of excuses, self-serving excuses. So the proper response to that is not reaffirming the values, right? It's rather attacking those neutralizations. Or as I say, what we need to do is not reaffirm our values, but rather neutralize the neutralizations. Thank you.
Okay, so my mind is having web-like pulses of ideas and thoughts and reflections directly related to this and all of these discussions that we're having. I was told not to use PowerPoint, and I said, well, the risk in that is my mind thinks like the web, so it might be difficult for me to be non-linear. So I have a few different things here that I'm going to share with you and thoughts up here, and just related to that, neutralizing the neutralizations. What I wanted to start off with was just my reflection on why this financial crisis actually hit, and the way I look at it is a values gap. And just in reflecting what some of those gaps are in values and how do you actually create that values shift, I mean, I guess neutralizing, as you kind of described there. And for me, the way that I think about it is focusing on where we start and when we're young and how our values are developed and how they're shaped and what influences us and how do those values get shaped within a society. And so when I... got designated this young global leader by the World Economic Forum. I was involved in a lot of different events taking place in Davos and also regional events. And so I was invited to some discussions that took place just right after the financial crisis. And they were having these different debates as to how to respond and what can be done with our global financial institutions. And they started to take a broader look at these different institutions, not just financial systems, but looking at different systems. And one track was literally of value systems and how do we look at our value systems. And so what I ended up proposing back last year, actually, was that we extend the questions about how we redesign our global systems to all generations, and especially to reach out to young people, to reach out to youth. And so I kind of raised the question a few times and was given the opportunity to sort of have, I guess, the ear. Really, it was my own initiative that did it, but I collaborated with a group of other sort of young global leaders, mostly, you had to be under 40, most people are in their 30s, so they're not youth, but more of a bridge, I guess, to younger generations. And what we ended up doing was created a discussion guide. And in over 30 countries, we consulted with thousands of youth to ask them, you know, if you could redesign the world, what would it look like? What would you do? And there was these different tracks, you know, so we have different systems. So what, our value system, what would you do? And so there was kids in Colombia that said, well, we would create an anthem, an international anthem, rather than just a national anthem, so that we could all sing, you know, this one song together, because part of what shapes, you know, conflict between countries is that sense of nationalism, and so we should create one international anthem that includes, you know, words from different languages. And other kids just talked about, you know, getting to know their neighbors, kids in rural environments and urban contexts, you know, just being able to bring people together. And that in urban environments, people don't tend to know their own neighbor. And so they talked about just being able to have those sorts of conversations with your neighbor about life, about love, about relationships, and just kind of growing common humanity bonds of friendship with people. And that having those bonds of friendship, you know, would allow you to care for other people. And if you care for other people, you wouldn't want to make decisions that would be hurtful or harmful to them. We had discussions about, you know, mitigating risks. And in India and Nigeria, there was a lot of talk about corruption and having harsher consequences when acts of corruption are taken, and creating more incentives for people to actually report incidents of corruption and having those consequences. So that became a huge recommendation. In the area of just strengthening the economies in general, there was a suggestion from kids in LA, which was to have internship programs. So really giving students and youth access to be able to grow and to develop their skills in their field of interest, because a lot of times, you know, people want to be able to take things further, but they don't have those opportunities. And by creating internships and having placements and being able to work in places outside of who you might know in your family, it could help people jump and develop their skills. In Rwanda, their suggestion for strengthening economies was to have a fund to invest in youth social ventures, social entrepreneurship, social enterprises, and that young people need access both to develop their skills, but also to have funds to be able to do it. In the area, one of the pillars was around ensuring environmental sustainability, and one of the huge recommendations from youth in Lebanon was to focus on, you know, renewable energy, and the overdependence on oil is just one of the causes for overconsumption and really creating a lot of conflict. And so young people were consulted from, you know, the age of 10 in Japan. Their ideas were expressed, actually kids age 10 and younger, through puppets. They created little puppet shows, and they had to express their ideas through little puppet shows. And they talked about the environment and how important it is to protect the ocean. And so what I've been very inspired by is not just the direct communication, because I've worked to engage children and youth for many years now, but it wasn't just that process, but actually getting world leaders and policymakers, you know, whether it be members of parliament in some countries, whether it be heads of corporations, to actually sit and listen to those kids. And just be reminded of the simplest things that may or may not be new ideas. In most cases, they're not necessarily new, but they really get at the heart of looking at problems in a very holistic way. And there's such an honesty and a truth when people are looking at problems and solutions without necessarily taking that institutional view or institutional lens. you can sort of see things clearly, and that's one of the reasons why I so strongly believe that it's critical, as we're shaping solutions for the future and policies for the future, to really have an intergenerational approach and to really make sure that the voices of kids and, you know, children and youth are really part of that. And that's why I was also happy to hear that there are, you know, young people here, and I know that it's something that definitely needs to be kind of expanded upon, even in forums like this, and I'm happy to be able to share some examples of what I've both personally been involved in and what's sort of possible in this whole sphere of digital media and social change. So just a little bit more about my own story. We're great on time. Okay. So 10 years ago, I was rollerblading with a friend, and I was thinking about what I wanted to do when I grew up. And I guess we all still ask ourselves that question, hopefully. And hopefully it's not just what we want to do later, but what we want to do today to create change in the world. What can I do to contribute? And as a teenager, I had a few opportunities. I grew up in Vaughan, and as a result of my mandatory community service hours, I didn't know what I wanted to do, so I volunteered at the Courtright Center for Conservation and the McMichael Canadian Art Collection and the local food bank. I volunteered at all these different places, and I did not have a history in my family of, you know, doing this kind of volunteer work. I was super privileged as a kid to be able to play sports. I got to play a whole range of sports, including, you know, hockey, soccer, ringette, tennis, basketball, volleyball. I played a lot of sports, but this community service really opened me up to realizing that I could make a difference in the world, and that by contributing to problems, that I was growing as a person, I was developing my skills, that my voice was important. I had an opportunity, because I started to get more involved in my community, to be part of a local youth advisory council, which was extremely transformative, to be able to sit and share with your, you know, your mayor what your ideas are for how to improve, you know, your city. And so by the time I was 19, I had all these chances to speak up and to be heard. And actually, I felt it really just wasn't fair. Why was I getting these chances? And it was completely random, and it was completely through this sort of grapevine. And so I had this idea while rollerblading to create an online hub and resource center, because at the time, this was back in 99, you know, everyone was talking about the internet as a tool for, you know, selling, you know, dot-coms, making a lot of money, and it seemed very focused on commercial purposes, you know, which is fine, but I thought, wow, I was rollerblading with a dot-com entrepreneur himself. His name is Michael Furtick, and we came up with this idea for Taking It Global together. He sold the company at 16, and we were talking about, what if we could shape the future of how we use the internet to actually contribute to humanity and to the environment and for social benefit, to actually help people create change in the world, you know, and so we started imagining all these ideas, and we were so frustrated because there's not really very many spaces, civic spaces. You know, if you think about community centers, they're very restricted. Schools, I mean, I went through the whole work to rule thing, which was really challenging, because as someone who was a really active student, you know, the schools were being shut down for two of my high school years, and there's not really many spaces where young people can go to really express themselves, you know, visually and just to create your space. It's very commercial. There's not those spaces in the physical environment. And so we had this idea called Taking It Global, which was to create a sort of civic space. Originally, the concept was not just virtual, it was both. It was actually creating these hubs and centers all around the world that encouraged people to just get involved and have a voice. And looking at this issue of how do you shape values, you know, while, again, this was my first year of university at the time, and I realized that we were suddenly into, you know, silos, and at the time I was focusing mostly on business, and I realized I needed an interdisciplinary kind of background. And so we invented this idea, this concept of creating a space. And we spent about a year pitching the idea, and we didn't raise money. We did end up doing a bunch of consulting projects, and we realized, okay, let's just do what we know, which is create the space online. So in September of 2000, we launched our takingitglobal.org online social network for social change, before the days of Facebook. And the idea was to really create that sort of social network platform as a way to provide opportunities for youth to have a voice, to connect to organizations where they could volunteer, to start their own projects and their own initiatives, and to become more active in the world. And I was very locally active, and I had this idea of thinking globally. I didn't know anyone from other countries, and the site grew. So basically, we've grown into this huge global network. It's in 12 languages. We've reached over 10 million people. And what's most interesting to me is that it's evolved, and our whole theory of change is really now evolved, because I ended up studying sort of in doing my master's research on youth-led action in an international context, and how do you engage citizens in the policy debate and actually shaping policy. And so there's a couple milestones that I've been very fortunate to sort of be a small little part of contributing to. So back in 2002, I ended up going to the World Summit on Sustainable Development in Johannesburg, and there was a youth caucus. And that's when I realized that these UN conferences have these civil society components, and that young people, and especially starting with sustainable development, started to have a voice. And so I was actively involved in these different meetings and just kind of learning what was going on. And it was one of my friends who told me about it. And so by 2003, we had launched our site. We were already getting sort of thousands of people. And with the International Institute for Sustainable Development, we launched the Youth Caucus for the World Summit on the Information Society. And we actually were one of the leading NGOs in the world mapped through this online sort of tracking of key online hubs that were contributing to civil society participation in this policy process. We ran national consultations in over 30 countries. Industry Canada was one of the supporters. And I was able to convince the government of Canada to take me on their government delegation. And Canada proposed the text for the youth paragraph, which was the first paragraph adopted because we had youth infiltrating other country delegations. And the text said that young people need to be empowered as learners, developers, contributors, and decision makers in the information society. And so between 2003 and 2005, we were quite active. And then we realized, okay, well, young people can have a voice in the future of shaping the web, but it shouldn't just be on youth. How do you actually involve youth across issues in all aspects of society? So we organized the online Habitat Jam in French and Spanish, and we partnered up with the World Urban Forum that came to Vancouver in 2004. And then when the International AIDS Conference came to Toronto, our offices being headquartered in Toronto, we played a major role convincing CETA that we needed a minimum of one full-time staff to be the youth program coordinator, and we ended up having a huge budget, and we mobilized thousands of youth to come to get scholarships, and in the Dr. Peter Piot, who was a former head of UNAIDS, actually said he knew more about the youth force than any of the other civil society groups. I think we were a little over-dominant because we were everywhere. We had posters, and we had people come to the youth pavilion and sign commitments to youth. We documented them, we recorded them. Minister from Mexico said he would double the youth participants from 1,000 to 2,000, and then 2 years later, that was met. So there are 2,000 youth in Mexico, and just a few weeks ago in Vienna at the International AIDS Conference, it's now an institutionalized part of how the International Conference takes place. And so I've had this privilege to be able to leverage the large potential, but small actual output, because I've now realized that I need to develop a little bit more patience for certain things. You can't give up too soon. And I've also had various frustrations. Copenhagen, I was there. We accredited 150 youth delegates as part of an NGO. We're one of the accrediting organizations, and we've helped to support a lot of Canadian youth delegates going to the COP climate change negotiations. And Copenhagen was just really frustrating for many people. I was there, actually, so on the day, there were about 100,000 on the streets, and I actually had a lot of conversations with lead negotiators, with heads of oil companies, heads of renewable energy companies, because of my World Economic Forum access, and which was obviously extremely privileged, and then was there on the streets with a lot of activists, indigenous activists, and really saw things from so many perspectives. And on this one night, my dinner plans got mixed up, and I was so stumped as to who to have dinner with, because I was literally wondering, how can I actually affect change? There's so much going on, and I'm just feeling really discouraged about the energy that so many people are pouring into this, and really, what's it all for? How do you actually create the change? So I wrote this poem. Oh, good, I still have enough time. Yes. I hope I'm not speaking too quickly. It's great to be back in Canada. I travel a lot, and I always get in trouble for speaking too fast. So let me just take a breath. I'm going to just take a sip of water. One second. Okay. Bouncing forward and back. Okay. So there's a lot of significance to this poem. The reason why. I wrote it sitting alone, wondering who I should have dinner with, and just literally realizing that the people you have dinner with somewhat affect your ability to affect change. And so as I was doing that, I wrote this poem, which I will read. The follow-up to the poem is that this was in December, so on January 1st, I woke up and I said, wow, I have six more months while I'm in my 20s, and then I turned 30 on June 27th. And I decided that there was a lot of things that I still wanted to do before I turned 30, which included having an art show. And so, anyways, I randomly decided that I would create an art show, and I booked the Gladstone Hotel June 27th. What happened on June 27th in Toronto, G20? But this was really originally all about me and my birthday, my 30th birthday. So anyways, I'm going to read the poem, and then I'll finish the story. How does change happen? This is perhaps one of those eternal questions that carries both simplicity and depths of complexity, juxtaposed in a tension so bright and dark that emotions explode and identities blur. Is your belief defined by your role, or is your role defined by your belief? How does change happen? Policy, says the policymaker. Market, says the business manager. Mass mobilization, says the organizer. Dialogue, says the convener. Systems change, says the academic. Imagination, says the artist. Invention, says the scientist. Innovation, says the technologist. Investment, says the banker. Design, says the architect. Enlightenment, says the spiritual guide. Rule of law, says the lawyer. Conviction, says the leader. Education, says the teacher. Data, says the analyst. Universal access, says the philanthropist. Healthy choices, says the coach. Awareness, says the communicator. Perspective, says the author. Crisis, says the journalist. Action, says the entrepreneur. Revolution, says the activist. Hope, says the dreamer. Network, says the connector. Inspiration, says the storyteller. Love, says the mother. Aspiration, says the father. Laughter, says the child. Possibility, says the youth. Reflection, says the elder. And so we ask ourselves where we stand, where we shine, and where we fly. We ask whether or not we are defined by the roles we take or the collective outcomes that emerge when our efforts and beliefs collide. Is it magic or tragic that we disagree? That's it. That's the poem. So what I did is I wrote this poem randomly, and then I started talking about it, and I illustrated in a painting, an acrylic painting, each of those 30 lines in between the preamble and the end. And at the Gladstone Hotel on June 27th, I had an art show. And I made flyers, and I sent them all throughout the whole city. I printed them, I sent them online, I sent it to thousands of people to invite. And I just, for the record, I'm just really pissed off that so many people didn't come because of the security and the fact that what we were discussing was something, you know, I had RCMP officers, who's an advisor, and he couldn't come because he was on call. I had so many people on the streets who are leading, you know, the Canadian Youth Climate Coalition, who are all arrested or detained. I had so many people that are just scared to come downtown because Toronto, it's like a war zone down there. So, you know, people shooting out of town. I mean, thankfully to the 100 family and friends that actually did come, and it was a beautiful event, but it was something that was all people that I directly, I mean, I really did a lot of convincing, like, it's going to be okay. I live beside the security zone, and I can get there, and I dealt with it on Saturday. But basically, I guess what my contribution is to this is, as we reflect on the future of shaping policy, and we reflect on the role as citizens and consumers, that we really need to create more exchanges, kind of like the spirit of Couchiching, actually, where you have people across disciplines and across mindsets actually coming together to create that magic, you know, that watershed moment, because otherwise I really think we're doomed. So that's all I have to say for now.
Yeah.
You gotta love that energy, really. A poetic, youthful energy. And a philosophical energy as well. I'm going to do something very verboten here. I won't call it a PowerPoint because I use open source software that my daughter lent me. I'm a firm believer of hacking the nation, the digital nation. But I will take us through some images. But I really would like to thank Couchiching really for exposing me to all these great speakers and this kind of great diversity and spectrum of ideas. And I thank you, too, for the kind of great questions you ask of the people up here. For me, there really shouldn't be a difference between the audience and the panelists. So we'll try to dissolve that audience, maybe that difference in the second half of this thing. But for now, I'll do my little bit here. And really thank you for inviting me to this YMCA re-education camp, I call it. Tonight, I want to take you on a kind of personal pilgrimage to retrace some steps I've been taking over the last couple of months to various watersheds. I mean, when they said it was about watersheds, I take things literally, so I went around the world. Really, I did. And so I'll speak about lessons I've learned in Krakow and London and Iceland and here in Canada. And I call this little thing the power of people. I'll talk about resistance and protests and the missing link in this debate we've been having or hearing, and not just here but everywhere, about the collapse and so-called recovery of the global economy. The missing link, it's been suggested, is really in this case tonight about the consumer or what we call the public or the people. And I know we've been billed perhaps in this panel to spill some polite vitriol, which I always take to be that gunky petroleum product that comes from Stephen Harper's tar sands and the Gulf of Mexico. But I'm not angry. This is not vitriol. I'm just an ordinary citizen filmmaker. And because I am, I'll get claim the right to project some images. You see, documentary filmmakers believe that images can change the world and that real people working together will change the world. So let's see if this works. I want to just really begin with protocol I learned when I was the thinker in residence in South Australia for the Premier Rand there in 2006. I want to acknowledge that we're meeting on the traditional lands of the Chippewa Rama First Nation. Their history is tied to the great Ojibwe migration in searching for a new homeland. And it's here, just at the fishing weirs that are just south of the lake down here. There's evidence there that they've been here for 4,500 years. So, great depressions or great recessions. These days, I really feel like the Earth is like spinning in the wrong way around. It's what I call the not so great regression. But we're talking really tonight about the bonfire, the Vanities. Well, that was a medieval tradition of burning objects that were deemed immoral or caused people to sin. Such bonfires were common at the sermons of Saint Bernard of Siena. Apparently, he is also the patron saint of advertising and gambling. As the old saint spoke, people would throw vanities, in those days, mirrors and cosmetics and fine dresses and artwork and books and music, all those things that really caused the big temptations. They'd throw those things into the bonfire, and probably some of my old films as well. So perhaps we'll recreate this kind of bonfire tonight later. But tonight, I'm really going to use the word watershed as a metaphor for places on Earth where rainwater or rivers or institutions and individuals can choose to go one way or another, this way or that. Sometimes these choices are the result of personal epiphanies. Sometimes they're more collective and active decisions. In the real world, a large watershed, it's called a continental divide. In Canada, we're really fortunate. We have this really special place in the Banff National Park on the Columbia Icefields, which is a triple continental divide. It's really where one little drop of water can decide whether or not to go to the Pacific Ocean or the Arctic Ocean or the Atlantic Ocean. But really, my watershed metaphor is really about choice and the choices that Canadians, as little drops of water or citizens of the world, need to make to survive the current economic and environmental crisis and the crisis of democracy. In other words, we want to look, should we look to the east, to China and India, as we were hearing this morning, or will we continue to look at the ways of the Western world, or will we look to our own true north, strong and relatively free? In other words, will we Canadians create our own interdependent and innovative and sustainable future? But first I want to talk about economists. Let me say that I'm not an economist. For me, an economist who gets very rich by explaining to others why they are so very poor. Well, I don't know. Well, maybe I'll do a version of the light bulb joke that Marilyn said the opening night. How many Chicago school economists does it take to change a light bulb? The answer is none, because if the light bulb really needed changing, the market would do it itself. I don't actually trust economists, you know. The biggest case in point really is 2 years before the great crash of 1929, the granddaddy of them all, Keynes, wrote that we will not have any more crashes in our time. Well, a few months later, he would lose all his own money in the great Wall Street crash as it drove itself into a brick wall. But I guess my feelings are really echoed by Galbraith, who was here at Couchiching, who said, "We have two classes of economic forecasters, those who don't know and those who don't know that they don't know." But really, from Galbraith, what we can really get is that the idea that one should comfort the afflicted, but also afflict the comfortable. So I'll begin my little road trip in Krakow in Poland, where I was a few months ago. It's a city which is 1,300 years old. After the Soviet Union created the People's Republic of Poland in 1945, the communist authorities encountered very strong resistance from the middle-class citizens of Krakow. And so to correct this imbalance and to teach the middle class a lesson, they built a new satellite town in the suburb of Krakow and called it Nowa Huta, and it was, I guess it was their version of a stimulus package. And it was a really a giant model town, and they flooded it with lower-class peasants and workers, and it really became a center of heavy industry and an ideal place to test communist propaganda, except for one thing. The people were not happy. The communists had decided that Nowa Huta would be a city without God. One type of building missing in their original plans for the suburb was a Roman Catholic church, but the angry citizens fought back. They erected a symbolic wooden cross that I went to visit on consecrated ground in a parking lot. They gathered by the thousands, really, when the government tried to remove the cross. And they began sit-ins and demonstrations, and they were joined by their local bishop. He's the guy who eventually became Pope John Paul II, the guy who's a kind of pit bull manner would erode the foundations of the Soviet system. It was also there in Nowa Huta a few years later that it became the site of the giant demonstrations against the system organized by the Solidarity trade union movement. And ironically, that revolt was formed by the descendants of those original peasant workers. Really, what goes around comes around. This is the watershed, what I call the watershed cross. For me, the struggle of ordinary people to challenge authority and defend their rights is a watershed. The Pope led his masses to victory. Capitalism moved in, following in his footsteps. And these days, in that little suburb, Nowa Huta, there's a giant, where there was a giant statue of Vladimir Lenin. It's been replaced by a copy of Frederick Chopin's piano, and they've renamed the square Ronald Reagan Square. Last month, I visited London in the streets near the city, which is what they call the business district there. I could still sense this power of the people. There was still this kind of resonance of the large protests held last year at their G20 summit. As usual, the isolated heads of state were there, meeting how to save democracy and save the world and maybe limit democracy, actually. But I was really there to visit a few hundred meters from there. The object of my pilgrimage was the Tower of London, home of the Crown Jewels. I wasn't really there in some kind of criminal behavior, because I'm a Canadian, and I've taken the documentary vow of poverty, but the Crown Jewels were there. But really, over the last 100 years, the tower has been used as a prison. The future Queen Elizabeth I, she was imprisoned there for her involvement in a protest march called the Wyatt Rebellion. In those days, queens were the type of people that did lead protests. My hero, Sir Thomas More, was imprisoned there and executed as well as a traitor. But I was not really there for that. I was there to see if the famous six ravens of the tower were still alive. You see, those six ravens have an important part to play in the history of the United Kingdom. King Charles II decreed that at least six ravens must be kept in the tower at all times. Legend has it that any failure to do so will cause the tower to fall down and a terrible disaster will befall England. To tell you the truth, I was hoping that the tower would fall down right while I was there. Given the dire state of the British economy, while I was there, they were releasing some kind of emergency budgets and all that. I really half expected that the ravens of the tower would be very, very, very dead. Indeed, sort of like the famous parrot in the Monty Python skit. I expected those ravens would be pushing up daisies. Would be, by all measures of the British economy, they should be ex-ravens. But the raven master I met, he's the guy that feeds those birds. He said, "Listen, big fella, those bloody ravens are all right. Leave them alone. They're the third most popular reason why the tourists come to the tower after the crown jewels and we, the beef eaters. Yes, I know," I told him, "they're the reason that I came, but also to see the grave of Sir Thomas More in his final resting place." He was a civil servant and a humanist who believed that the king should work for the people and not vice versa. This is a kind of ethical, philosophical position, but it led to his execution. Nevertheless, he was canonized in 1935 and became a patron saint of lawyers and politicians. I'm not sure if that's such a good thing, but he's my hero anyway. He coined the word utopia, which comes from the Greek language. It means no place. But for More, utopia was an ideal imaginary place where private property doesn't exist. There's communal ownership of land, men and women are educated equally, and religions are tolerated. This sounds like Canada to me. Then on my little road trip last month, I went to Iceland. Iceland is a watershed nation. The recent economic meltdown there represents a micro version, I think, of what is happening in the rest of the world. Iceland is a canary in a coal mine or a fat troll stuck in a volcano, so to speak. I won't describe, but I did read this book. I would really highly recommend it, Meltdown by the Times of Iceland, by the Times of London author Roger Boyce. Meltdown Iceland, How the Global Financial Crisis Bankrupted Iceland, the Happiest State in the World. In brief, Iceland had everything going for it. In 2008, it was number one in the United Nations Human Development Index. I always thought Canada was, but Canada is now ranked number 4, and the First Nations people of Canada are ranked number 72. Anyway, there's a lot of detail about the Icelandic meltdown, but I won't get into that. In 2001, the Prime Minister of Iceland, who was a good disciple of Milton Friedman, privatized two state banks and slashed corporate taxes and by two-thirds. And eventually, in a combination of what I call greed and folly, the economy erupted, and the fallout metaphorically scattered its ashes all over the Western world. However, I didn't go to Iceland to talk numbers and eulogies. I went to investigate watersheds and continental divides and paradigm shifts. Especially here in the Þingvellir plain, there are really only two places on Earth where you can actually see two continents drifting apart, in the Great Rift Valley in Africa, and also in this plain in central Iceland, where the North American and the Eurasian plates are separating. But somehow, either symbolically or by design, it was here at this rift along the continental divide that the world's first parliament was formed in the year 930 AD. It's a parliament which still continues to this day. They call it the Althing, the first parliament in the world. As an outdoor assembly, the Althing was created by a group of chieftains who wanted to limit the power of the most powerful. Not a bad idea. All free men could attend. Thousands of people came from all over the country. And on a natural outcrop of the continental divide, what they call the Law Rock, which I saw, provided a natural platform for delivering speeches. Anyone was entitled to present their case on the important issues of the day. It sounds a bit like Couchiching to me. But this is really what real democracy and real parliament can look like. And that spirit lives on in the capital city, now where the parliament has been relocated, and in the current crisis over the last 2 years, the heroic ordinary Icelanders have been fomenting their own kind of version of the American Revolution. They call it the Kitchenware Revolution. I guess it takes its name from also the things that were happening in Argentina a while back, or the Pots and Pans Revolution. And we really haven't heard much about this revolution in our mainstream kind of agenda-setting media. It began in 2008 when a musician named Hordert made his own kind of personal watershed decision to stage a one-man protest. He stood in front of the Icelandic parliament, and he invited, with his open microphone, and he invited people up to speak and speak out against what was happening. These protests eventually grew, and a coalition was formed, and they staged rallies every Saturday in front of the parliament. And some weekends, there were 6,000 people who showed up. That's 2% of Iceland's population. Now, can you imagine in Canada if, 65,000 Canadians, came protesting every weekend in front of Ottawa's Parliament Hill? I'm sure the security system would go nuts. They were banging their pots and pans in front of the Prime Minister's house and to distraction until the Prime Minister and his government stepped down. It became really the first administration to be ousted because of this present global financial crisis. There were new elections held, and Iceland now has its first female and openly lesbian Prime Minister. I guess we can learn in Canada a few things from Iceland. One can argue about the effectiveness of large public demonstrations. For one thing, the security state, I do think, is growing very effective at repressing them. However, centuries of human history show us that they can be very effective. Where would the civil rights movements be, and the feminist movements, and the anti-war movements, and the environmental movements without recourse to the streets? For me, the biggest mass, biggest example really is the biggest mass demonstration in the history of the world on February 15th in 2003, protests against the U.S.-led invasion of Iraq. That weekend, 30 million people protested in 800 cities in 60 countries around the world. And in my city, Montreal, we had 150,000 people demonstrating outside in the kind of freezing cold. Now, we could argue whether or not those 2003 demonstrations were successful or not. I think they were a kind of immediate failure. The Americans did, and their allies did, invade Iraq. And yes, I would argue those, but those protests, I think, did enable Obama, in a way, eventually, to get elected on an anti-war, let's pull the troops out ticket. And today, next month anyway, the U.S. will be vacating Iraq. But of course, they're doing this kind of current hypocritical surge into Afghanistan. But eventually, I think the masters of war on all sides of that conflict, too, will withdraw from that foolish enterprise because of public pressure. Now, we'll move to our kind of current local example, the one that was giving you such a hard time attracting spectators to your poetry art show. It's really, well, we know about it, and we're, I think there have been these 2 decades of public outcry against market fundamentalism, and part of that has happened really in a continuum at the Toronto photo op, G20 photo op, not just in terms of tactical protests. I think they've been successful, but also I think long-term educational grassroots ways as well. But I think the G20 was a kind of operatic version of that, and the G8 summit as well. The official story, I guess, we all know, and there's the official photograph. But these largely stage-managed events only cost the Canadian taxpayers, as we know, $1 billion, and that's really a small price to pay, I guess, to test out our new integrated security system, as they call it now. But just in case the international journalists covering the summit got the wrong idea about Canada, there was a $23 million center built for them, too. And here's, it was hard to find this picture, but here it is, the infamous artificial lake in the Experience Canada Pavilion. It was this, I don't know, a fake lake in a country which has more real fresh lakes than any other country of the world. It didn't make any sense to me. But the virtual set in that place included plastic canoes and a big screen to put up mythological images of Canada and a shoreline with those famous Muskoka deck chairs so that journalists could cool off from all that hard work they were doing reporting on the truthiness of the summit. When it opened for business, the artificial lake received skeptical reviews from the Canadian public, I think, and I also think it was not well reviewed by swimmers. Here we have Mr. Harper teaching his fellow summit people how to imitate our famous group of seven. It's an art appreciation class. You would appreciate that. It's how to paint by numbers. Well, it's all about numbers. At the G20 summit, the inevitable peaceful protests were organized, and 1,000 people were arrested, some of your friends, some of my friends. And a former film studio was used as a temporary detention center. I imagine that some of those arrested included down-of-luck filmmakers who had once worked in that film studio. Which gets me to my friend Michael Moore, and I'll ask the same question that he asked in his film Capitalism, A Love Story. Is the present economic system, capitalism, incompatible with democracy? The long answer is yes. Currently, as we've heard here, our rulers want 3 things from the global economy: growth, growth and more growth. Okay, I mean, that's only one thing, but I can't count. But there are alternatives, and many of you here are working on them. Over the last 20 years, large global justice movements have opposed neoliberal globalization and turbo capitalism, where transnational corporations have unregulated power. They're organized, as you're organizing, Jennifer, through web networks and worldwide public movements are calling for a global integration that better provides for democratic representation, advancement on human rights, fair trade, and sustainable development, where people's basic needs are placed before profits. A few years ago, I made this film with Mark Akbar called Manufacturing Consent, Noam Chomsky in the media. Chomsky thinks that the term globalization has been appropriated by the powerful, while the advocates of alternative forms of economic organization are marginalized and described as anti-globalization. But for Chomsky, no sane person is opposed to globalization. That is international integration. Surely not the left, nor the workers' movements, which were founded on the principle of international solidarity. That is globalization in a form that attends to the rights of people, not private power systems. So I propose different terminology to define these alternative views. Perhaps we should call ourselves globalist instead of globalized, or global local, which is a word that fuses global with local. In my ideal world, it's a Groucho Marxist world, I know, but I propose that we make room for green economics to address the interdependence of human economies and natural ecosystems. I propose that we make room for open civil societies. I propose that we, the privileged few, move over and make room for all the other people of this world to hear their voices, to share their visions. And I propose that we take all of our existing greed-based systems and toss them into the bonfire of the vanities, and we can start that tonight. I also suggest that, like Mahatma Gandhi has taught us, that we should live simply so that others simply may live. So this is a watershed moment. Opportunities must be seized. And finally, like Sir Thomas More, I believe that utopias are possible. Utopias can and do exist, and I've visited a lot of them. I've been shooting a film for several years now on real and actual utopias, as I define them anyway. Utopian thinking is a process, not a destination. Utopian thinking is the belief that every individual, every society, every state can embrace the possibility of creating a better world. Utopia is not a disease of misplaced idealism. It is rather a constant craving for something better, not bigger, not greater, but better. Utopias are about images and visions. Utopias place pictures of possible worlds in our minds. By building utopias, we can define our collective and individual stories. These days, wherever we look in the world, and I guess wherever we look in this room, ordinary people are confronting dystopia. They are solving in their own powerful manners the ecological, political, and practical problems which are overwhelming the atomized and globalized us. Utopian thinking can teach us how to overcome the age-old war between human and nature, the conflict that permeates and consumes every aspect of our hollow consumer world of vanities. Utopian thought and massive change as applied creative intelligence might be the only solutions to this present economic crisis and future ones. Finally, once the power of people is unleashed and a better world is realized, we no longer have to call it utopia. It will simply be the way it is, the watershed way of the world. But now, It's up to you. Thank you.